Welcome. I'm Casey from Servants Heart Worship Center in Columbia, Tennessee. Don't forget to subscribe and like us on Facebook to be notified of new videos and live streams. Links to our Facebook and website are below. Satan, like a thief in the night, and while we are spiritually asleep, will enter our lives and steal our happiness, our love, and our meaning, leaving us lost and in the dark. We then have two choices: to wander in that darkness for eternity, or to seek that light in the darkness that is Jesus, and take back what was stolen from us while we were asleep. So open your Bible, have some prayer time, and ask the Holy Spirit to speak to you through today's message entitled, Take It Back.
Everybody knows that this nation is under attack from a spiritual wickedness that comes from high places. But the God we serve has more power than the enemy. And I was talking to Pastor about the enemy coming into our camp. I'm talking about our great nation, not just this camp, but our entire country has come into our camp and stolen from everyone in here's had something taken. You know, look around at all the people that are gone. Sickness, you know, death in the family, whatever it might be, but I'm here to tell you that God wins in the end, you know. So we're going to go into the enemy's camp and we're going to take back what he's stolen. Marriages, finances, health in our bodies, relationships with family members, the fire, the Holy Spirit that God put in us to be here, to serve him, to praise him. People don't have that anymore. The enemy is a good liar. He's a great deceiver. And so many people are falling for it. And it's time we go to the camp and take back what God has given us, you know. The enemy took it, and we're going to take it back. I have some scripture I want to read you right quick. I don't want to take up a lot of pastor's time. But this is what the Lord laid on my heart from Jeremiah this morning. It's 15 and 19. He says, therefore, this is what the Lord says. If you repent, I will restore you that you may serve me. If you utter worthy, not worthless words, you will be my spokesman. Let these people turn to you, but you must not turn to them. I will make you a wall to this people, a fortified wall of bronze that they will fight against you, but will not overcome you, for I am with you to rescue and save you, declares the Lord. I will save you from the hands of the wicked and deliver you from the grasp of the cruel. He's talking about the enemy right there, plain and simple. And here's another one in Jeremiah 29. You all know this one. 29 and 10 or 11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. Do I need to say any more? Thank you.
Praise God. John 10, verse 10 says, the thief, this is the words of Jesus, the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy, and it's no coincidence that Jesus put those things in that order, because Satan always begins his attack. This is one thing we need to remember. Satan always begins his attack on believers with a lie. It starts with a lie, and then the process gets snowballing. Then it goes from a lie to a theft. So he starts by lying to you. Then he starts his attack on us by stealing something from us. And Satan is slick. Satan is like a pickpocket. He can steal from us without us even realizing it's happening. Did you know Satan can steal your desire for the things of God? Well, I thought we were covered in the blood. And what about Satan can't cross the bloodline? Satan can't cross anything on his own, but we can let him into any area that we want to let him into. Satan can steal from us. Steal our zeal. He can steal our passion and desire for the things of God, because this world is Satan's kingdom. Satan can bless us. He could make us so successful and blessed in this world that it distracts us so much that all we focus on is the things of the world, the things we're getting in the world, our own success. Pride takes over, and he begins to steal our desire for the things of God by making us successful in the world, which is his kingdom. And what happens in this process is, as he's starting to steal our desire for the things of God, it happens slowly over time. So we don't even realize it's happening. We can't even see or track our own decline of our spiritual condition because we're distracted by the things of the world. We begin to fall asleep spiritually. I've preached a lot about falling asleep spiritually. It's all through the Bible. And someone asked me recently, how do you know when you're falling asleep spiritually? Is it just that you're not coming to church like you used to? And it's like, well, that's part of it. But it starts with our desire in our heart for the things of God. It's the same process in our physical condition as boredom. Spiritual slumber is just like boredom. Because how can we explain to ourselves where boredom comes from? We've got toys, we've got things that we love to do, we've got all kinds of options, we're in a free country, we got money in the bank, we could go here, we could go there, but sometimes we just get bored. There's no reason for it. We just get bored. That same vein of our human psyche is where Satan puts us to sleep spiritually. We begin to get bored with the Lord, and we're not even conscious of it. And it's in our slumber that we begin to die. And the longer we sleep spiritually, the more likely it is that we are going to die in our sleep, spiritually speaking. Starts with a lie. Then he steals something from us. We start dying spiritually, and it destroys our relationship with God. It destroys our Christian walk. That is how this verse from the mouth of Jesus comes to life in the life of you and I as believers. This is how Satan steals, kills, and destroys our Christian walk. Brett and I were talking, and he was fired up. The Holy Spirit was on Brett. The Holy Spirit was speaking through Brett, because I'd woke up a couple of hours earlier and I was thinking on along the same lines, and I was in my Bible study and I was reading and saying, Lord, this is Monday morning. What do you want me to preach? What do you want me to preach, Lord? And I began to think about things like that, and then Brett calls and we began to talk, and the more he talked, I began to write it down. And I wrote on a post-it note, take it back. Because Satan has stolen, not only from this nation, not only from believers, the body of Christ, but you and I as individual believers. And if we want to get back what he's stolen from us, if we want to get back what we've lost, we've got to go back to the scene of the crime. We've got to go back to what we left behind. When I was a kid, I was always misplacing stuff. And my mom, she would say, "Mom!" I think the neighborhood must have thought her name was Mom, because I would yell from wherever, "Oh, Mom!" wherever I was. And she'd always say, "Hey, Mom, have you seen this?" And she'd say, "Go back to the last place you remember having it." And I'd literally, she goes, I know where it's at, but I'm not going to tell you. So I'd have to sit there and think. It was an exercise in thought, taking me back in my mind. Where was the last place I remember having it? And I would remember, and I would go back there, and sure enough, there it was. This is what we have got to do spiritually. If you want to get back what you've lost as a believer, what Satan has stolen from you, and come into the camp and stolen from you as an individual believer, you've got to go back to what you left behind. In 2 Kings 8, Elisha, the prophet, told a godly woman to leave her home and farm because God was bringing a 7-year famine into that land. Can you imagine that? You're living your life, you're a farmer, you've got a field, everything's doing fine, and here comes the prophet. And he says, you got to pack up, uproot your life, and leave this land and go into the land of the enemy, the Philistines. You got to leave this land and go into that land for 7 years because God is bringing a famine into this land. And she did it without hesitation. She packed up in her stuff and she left for 7 years because she knew the power of God in Elisha's life, because Elisha had raised her child from death, brought her child back to life. So she left for 7 years. Look at 2 Kings 8, verse 3. And it came to pass at the end of 7 years that the woman returned from the land of the Philistines, and she went to make an appeal to the king for her house and for her land. She went and asked the king if he'd be willing to give her back her home and her farm. Because back then, it was illegal for a person to leave their land or their home for a period more than 2 years. If you left your home for more than 2 years, it was considered abandonment, and the government would confiscate it and sell it. The only way you could get around that law was if you left a caretaker in charge of the land, so the government could still collect their taxes. Yes, that was going on all the way back then. The government standing there with their hand out for property taxes. So this woman, she knew that she had left her home and her farm unattended for 7 complete years. She knew. That's why she had to go make an appeal to the king. She had to plead to the king to give her home and her land back, because she knew that she had no legal right to it. She had forfeited her right to her own home and her land by leaving it unattended. She knew that not only could she not the king deny her request, her appeal, but that he could arrest her and put her in jail for tax evasion and for abandonment of property, because abandonment of property was a crime at that day and time. Look at verse 6. And when the king asked the woman, she told him. So the king appointed a certain officer for her, saying, "Restore all that was hers, and all the proceeds of the field from the day that she left the land until now." Even though she left for 7 years, the king showed her mercy. He had every right to cast judgment upon her, but he chose to show her mercy. And he not only gave her back her home and her land, but he also gave her back all of the proceeds that her farm had made in her absence. The king had the right to cast her away, but he chose to show her mercy and give her back what was hers. Doesn't that sound a lot like salvation? Do you see how this is a picture of how God is with us? In that verse, it says, and it starts off, verse 6, and when the king asked the woman, what is she asking him? As you read back and you read through this story, you'll see that Elisha was telling the king about the woman and the woman's son, how God rose him from the dead. God used him to raise this child, to bring this child back to life. And the king, that's what he saw. Because at that moment, this woman was walking by. And Elisha's like, it's her. That's the one I was telling you about. And the king asked her, is this true? And the woman said, yes. This woman had a child that she loved. And that child had died. I know some of you have experienced that in this room. The death of a child is a pain like no other, from what I understand. And she knew that Elisha was a man of God, because her son, who was dead, is now alive again. Does that sound familiar? Remember, the brother to the prodigal son was all worked up about why the brother got this treatment and he didn't. And the father said, it's because your brother, who was dead, is now alive again. So this woman understood that Elisha was a man of God. And so she trusted him. So she instantly went in, packed up her stuff, and she left for 7 years. And Elisha is the one who told her to do it. So when the king sees her and hears the story, he knows that God's hand's in it, because as you read the story, you'll see that the king loved Elisha. He trusted Elisha like the woman did. And so he knew that God's hand was in it. So he gave her back everything with value added. This is a picture of us and what God does with us. And this story also shows us, as believers, a biblical principle that we can apply to every single area of our life. If we want to get back what we've lost or what we've walked away from, we've got to go back to what we left behind. If we're out of shape and we want to get back in shape, we got to go back to exercising and eating right. If we leave exercise and proper nutrition, it's going to have negative benefits on us. We're going to lose our health. But the good news is, we can take it back. We can get back all that we've lost if we just go back to what we left behind. If we go back to diet and exercise, we can get back in shape. If somebody has a job, Sister Loretta and I were talking, and Brother Vern on the way last Sunday going to see David, Loretta was talking about health benefits and coverages, and she was talking about her life and how she was fortunate in her life to have a very good job with good benefits. So if you have a good job with good benefits and you leave that job, you cannot expect to keep the benefits. If someone leaves the job, you lose the benefits. Spiritually speaking, if we leave our relationship with God, we will lose the benefits of that relationship. Well, Pastor Rob, my Bible says that God will never leave us or forsake us. That's true. The Bible says, draw nigh unto me and I'll draw nigh unto you. We take a step closer to God, he takes a step closer to us. But if we walk away from God, God just stays right there. God's in the last place you left him. We're the ones that walk away. We create the distance. If you want to get back what you've lost, you got to go back to what you left behind. Tell you what, if we leave as believers, if we leave a life of dedication, consecration to God, we're going to lose something. If we leave a life of prayer, we're going to lose our communication with God. If we leave a life of praise, we're going to lose our joy of the Lord, because if we leave something, we lose something. America has lost some things as a society. America has lost, and those of us that are a little older remember a time when we had these things. America has lost its modesty. We've lost our decency and our morality. We've lost our fear of the Lord and our respect for for the things of God. It used to be, even if you were a criminal and you weren't even a Christian, you would have respect for the house of the Lord, but no more. If we leave our relationship with God, we lose the benefits of that relationship. We cannot leave holiness. We can't walk away from holiness and not lose godliness. Amen? We can't walk away or leave being separated from sin and being separated from the pleasures and the things of this world. We can't leave those things without it costing us something. If we leave our life in Christ, we'll lose a lot. Remember a couple months ago, I was talking about how the animals in the wild, they have different marks of distinction, what scientists call them. And they're a mark like on the back of the ear, back of the tail, or on the hind quarters of a deer or something that only the deer's offspring can see and notice. That way they don't get lost in the landscape. White-tailed buck deer, they lift their tail. If their young ones are following behind and they get lost, all they have to do is when mom or dad lifts that tail, they see that white, that's the mark of distinction, and they know that the path is clear and they could run to the Father. See, this is what you and I are in this world. Our Christianity is a mark of distinction that separates us from the world. That people who don't even know, who we don't even know, are watching us and watching our witness, are watching us from a distance. They need to see our mark of distinction. They need to know that guy's a Christian. So when the time comes and they want what we've got, they have a clear path that you don't blend in so much with the world that they can't notice your mark of distinction. That's why God has called Christians to live separate from sin. We're to abstain from all appearances of evil. But sin has become fashionable again in the church. The church meaning the body of Christ. There's a lot of things that the Bible calls sin that are being reintroduced into the body of Christ, into church. So we can't leave our relationship with God and not lose our mark of distinction. If we leave something, we lose something. It's that simple. And it's because Satan, the thief, has lied to us, the chief of liars, and he has stolen, killed, and is in the process of destroying our relationship with God when we fall asleep spiritually. There's a Latin phrase, post hoc ergo propter hoc. It means therefore because of it. In other words, this happened because of that. Anytime I see a Christian walking away from God, and I could see it, I could see the decline in their spiritual zeal, I could see the decline in their relationship with God, and I do everything I can as a pastor and as a brother to talk to them and warn them, and until they get mad at me and stomp their foot and say, quit telling me about this stuff, I know. But I do everything I can to try to speak the truth into them. But there's a spirit of Antichrist that is flowing free throughout the earth right now. People are rejecting. It used to be they would reject the Word of God. Now they're rejecting the fact that the Bible is the Word of God and that there even is a God. Some of the church is teaching us that we can live any way we want and still be okay with God. Can you imagine that? But the good news is, if the church, if we want to get back what we've lost, all we have to do is go back to what we left behind. Amen? Because there is no middle ground. All roads do not lead to God. Jesus said, you're either for me or you're against me. People say, well, I'm a good man, I'm a good woman, I don't have anything, I love God, I help the poor, I do this or that. You're either for him or against him. There is no middle road. You're either saved or you're lost. There is no kind of saved and kind of lost. You're either saved or you're lost. And your fruit is what shows whether you're saved or whether you're lost. First thing. That's why, you know, if somebody says, I'm losing my joy in the Lord. You want your joy back? Really? Then go back to praising. Start praising God again, because praise brings joy. Well, I've just lost my desire for the things of the Lord. Go back to praying every day and having a prayer life and a Bible study life. God will bring back your excitement and your joy. Well, I just don't have time in my life. That's the first question I ask people when they come and they want to counsel about a problem or a crisis in their life. The first thing I say, I ask is, how's your prayer life? Because God knows we have an internet life, we have a social life, we have a work life, we have a television life. So how's your prayer life? Do you have a regular prayer, a powerful prayer life? That's what I love about the PIF team. It's an honor to be on that team. It's a ministry, it's a privilege, it's a cut above, because it brings people back in line with having a prayer life every single day. It keeps us on track. Can I get an amen? Amen. We cannot leave our prayer life behind and not lose something spiritually. So if you know that there's things in your life, spiritually speaking, that you have lost, the good news is, fear not, because you can get it all back. If you just go back to what you left behind. If you're feeling conviction in your heart right now because you know there's areas in your life that aren't up to par spiritually, you know it. The Holy Spirit's telling you that right now. It's not because of what I'm saying. But if you know in your heart right now that what I'm saying is truth, that's the conviction of the Holy Spirit, and that's God's way of telling you that there's a problem in your life and it's costing you spiritually. I don't know what stage you're in, but every spiritual battle we fight is part of the stage that starts with a lie, then secondly is a theft, thirdly, he kills something, and fourthly, he destroys something. Destroying it means it's beyond repair, it's destroyed. But the good news is, if you're feeling that in your heart, you can get it all back right now. You can get back what you lost by going back to what you left. Judges 16 says that the reason Samson lost his power wasn't because of his hair. That was the outward sign. That was the symbol. But it really had nothing to do with his hair. His hair was a representation of his Nazarite vow. The vow that he had with God. And part of that vow was purity. No alcohol. No sex with anybody that isn't your wife. In fact, I don't even think they could be married. But the reason Samson lost his power is because he lost his purity. He walked away from his purity. Because purity, in all forms, produces power. As long as Samson kept his vow to God, to live a life dedicated to God, he had power. But when he broke his vow, when he broke his promise to God and quit doing what he told God he would do, then God stopped doing what he said he'd do. The covenant was broken. All because Samson gave up his purity. See, this principle works the same in you and I as believers. If we leave the principles and precepts of God, of God's word, then we lose the power and the presence of God in our lives. But we can take it back. But I'm telling you, the church today has got to stop preaching and teaching that you can live any way you want and you're okay with God. Taking the scriptures about grace so far out of context, it's heresy. Because I believe this mentality of you can serve God for a while and then you can leave God for a couple of years. And it doesn't matter if I'm faithful to the house of the Lord. Nobody's taking roll. I can go a week and then stay home a week and come for 2 weeks and leave for five. This idea of the lack of reverence for the house of God in your personal life is the curse of this generation. And it's costing you spiritually to think that way. And people that I've ministered to that have that mentality, they get mad at me like I'm the one that makes the rules. And they come at me, well, God doesn't work that way. And a lot of times, 9 out of 10 times, people that want to live half in and half out, remember, Jesus said you're either for me or against me. There's no middle road. You're either saved or you're not. And most people that want to live on two different roads, a little bit of the world, a little bit of God, they'll leave a spirit-filled church to go to a church that'll teach them and tickle their ears and tell them exactly what they want to hear. This is exactly what Jesus warns us about for the last days, for this period in time in which we live. So we've got to get it back. We've got to get back what Satan has stolen from us. And a lot of people claim, I minister to a lot of people, and a lot of people claim to me, they come and they say, I just can't find the joy anymore, and I just don't like it, and something's happened, and it's, remember, it's the process of getting bored. They can't explain to me why. It's not a trial in their life. Everything seems to be good. The bills are paid. They just don't want to be faithful to the house of God or to the things of God. They don't want to be faithful to the Father's house or to the Father. They want to come and go as they please. See, this is the same thing that God, the same burr that got under the saddle of the prodigal son in his father's house. And they say, well, I want it. I want to get back and have what I used to have spiritually. I want to be strong again. But the truth is, I say, you can go back and get, just go back to what you left behind. Go to the last place you remember having it. Go back to that first love in your life, that first love for God, and get it back. Take it back. But the truth is, they don't want to go back to that level of dedication in their life. There was a time in their life when they had to be in the house of the Lord. I used to get calls, are we having a Sunday night service? Well, sorry, we only got 2 people that come, so, well, I'm going to go somewhere else. I'm going to go find a church. They were so hungry for God. Are we having prayer meeting tonight? Nope. Well, they would get together and have home groups and have prayer meetings. And we used to go to other people's houses to have prayer meetings because they were so hungry for the things of God. So they say they want it back. They want to take it back. But they don't want to go back to what they left behind. And it doesn't work that way. God will give it all back to you. But you got to go back to what you left behind. Can I get an amen? Amen. We got to go back to being set apart. We got to go back to being broken before the Lord and being so in love with Jesus that we are willing to take up our cross and follow Him wherever it is He leads us. Amen. Let's be the kind of people, the kind of church that doesn't let Satan tickle our ears. Let's go back to what we left. Let's get our hunger back. Let's go back to the well, back to the beginning, and be a people who's not going to allow the enemy to trick us, to steal, kill, and destroy what God has put into our lives. Let's take it back. Nobody can afford to lose God's presence in their life. So Samson, he lost everything because he left his purity. He stopped doing what he promised God he would do. God said, if you do this, I'll do that. And they had this arrangement. He was the strongest man in the world. And as soon as he started walking away from that, he started to lose his ability. He lost, at the end, he lost his power, his strength, he lost his vision, his dignity, his liberty, his freedom. And his reputation, he lost his eyeballs. They gouged him out and made a fool of him. He lost everything, but the most costly thing that Samson lost was he lost his usefulness to God. Look at Judges 16:20. Delilah. This is, if you know the story, after several times of Samson tricking her, she finally got the secret. And she told the Philistines about it. Judges 16:20, then she, Delilah, cried out, Samson, the Philistines have come to capture you. Listen to this carefully. When he woke up, he was asleep. Satan had him in that third stage of spiritual slumber, the stage that right before death, when he woke up, he thought, I will do as before, and I will shake myself free. But he didn't realize, here we go, the Lord had left him. When I was in a drug-addled condition, addicted, and a lot of you can relate to this, some may not, but the truth is I always had this mentality, well, I could sin, I could go out and do this, and God loves me, and he's always going to forgive me. So I would intentionally sin and then say, oh God, please forgive me, please forgive me. And then I'd go back and do what I was going to do. The whole time it was premeditated. I had this thing. It was like I had this insurance policy that I knew God would always forgive me. And I began to take that totally for granted and use it out of the context in which it was given to me. God will only take that for so long. I used to figure, I'll get all drugged out and then I'll shake it off. Well, I'll wake up and shake it off like I've done a million times before, and I'll have the power to come back and go get back what I had lost. But there came a point when God left me. He was right where I left him. In my mind, God, you left me. And God goes, no, I didn't. I'm right here where you left me. God was here. I began to walk away and walk away, and then I'd come back an inch and walk away 10 feet and come back 6 inches, walk away 30 feet. And after a while, I was so far out of sight that I had no power to shake off what I'd always been able to shake off, and my addiction got really ugly, really fast. Because when you're addicted to something that you have to have, from the second you wake up to the time you go to bed 3 days later, if you have to have that and you cannot function without it, and it's all illegal and it's trying to kill you, it's a very terrible life. And I would cry out to God, but my heart wasn't crying. My head was crying out to God. I wanted off the roller coaster, but my heart wasn't ready to say, I'm broken before you and I surrender. I was where Samson was. She cried out, Samson, the Philistines have come to capture you. When he woke up, he thought, I'll just do as before and shake myself free of this. But he didn't realize the Lord had left him. Samson lost God's attributes and favor in his life because he left his devotion to God. What did he do? He traded his vow to God and all the benefits that came with that. He left all of those benefits. He traded it for a sexual affair with an ungodly woman who was sent specifically by the enemy. By the enemy. Yeah, the Philistines, but the greater enemy, Satan. Because Satan wanted to steal, kill, and destroy everything God had done in Samson. This is our story, y'all, because this happens the same exact way today in the lives of believers. If we leave behind the principles of God, we lose the power of God in our life. But because he loves us, if we come back, we can get it all back. Elisha told the woman to pack up and leave for 7 years because of the famine. And when she did, she gave up all of her rights. But the key to this story is when she came back, she wanted to take it back. She knew what she had to do. The first thing that she had to do was go and talk to the king. He was the one who gave it all back because he was the only one who had the power to forgive her trespass. It's the same story with us. When we walk away from God, we may think we can shake it off like all the other times. Oh, Lord, forgive me, and then I'll be okay with God. And we could be on this loop of we're really not living a Christian life and we're not living a worldly life. But every second that we live that way, God's power is moving in the opposite direction. Not because he's moving, but because we're moving. And if we want to get it back, we've got to go back to where we were before. When we realize all the enemy's stolen from us and we want to take it back, first thing we got to do is go talk to the king. My prayer for this nation, my prayer for every individual believer in the world, especially in the United States, my prayer for all y'all in this church and for every individual Christian is that if we want to get back what we once had and we want to be strong spiritually like we once were, that we will go and we will talk to the king. For every believer who's let Satan steal, kill, and destroy their spiritual life, here we go, by abandoning what they had when a famine came. A spiritual famine came. Spiritual famines create boredom. Spiritual famines create fickleness. It's always a trial that leads somebody. They start their downhill slide when a trial comes into their life most of the time. So I'm praying that they'll come back and they'll appeal to the king. They'll bow down before him, confess him as Lord, and get back everything that they had. And you know what? I've seen people walk away from what God was doing in their life, and they just keep losing and losing and losing ground spiritually. I'm dealing with them right now as we speak. I'm dealing with four people in this condition in my life. They say they want it back, but they don't want to give up what they've done. They don't want to acknowledge what they've done as sin or what they're doing as sin. They've walked away. And you know, they're trying to fill. What I've noticed is when God comes into our heart, he cleans the world out. When we accept Christ into our heart, the first thing he does is he starts going to work on us and he's cleaning out the things of the world and he's making a home proper for him to live in. Okay? So, for everything he throws out from the world that he throws out of our life, he fills with his light. The Holy Spirit fills it with light. Then, if up the road we decide to start letting the world back in and we start walking away from God and we start that trek away from God and that light in our heart gets dimmer and dimmer and dimmer, we have a big hole in our heart. And a lot of people who are walking away from God will try to fill that hole with things of the world. They get new houses, new jobs, bigger cars, they get toys, they do anything they can to fill that void. That void that was left when they abandoned their spiritual things, the things of God. But what they don't realize is that you can fill that hole with the whole world and it'll never satisfy. Because a God-shaped hole can only be healed and filled by the Holy Spirit of God. That's why Paul said, what is it to gain the whole world and lose your soul? But so many people try to fill their life with other things. And all that does, you know, when I'm counseling and praying with them, one hand they want to get it back, and another hand they don't want to go back to that level of devotion that they had to God. And it's like I'm watching. When I'm sitting there talking to them, in my spirit, I feel like I'm watching a crime being committed. I'm watching a rape, and I can do nothing about it. I'm watching a crime happening. I'm watching Satan in action, stealing and killing and destroying this person who loves God. and I can do nothing about it. Except for keep praying and pull others in to pray with me. I'm watching Satan kill the relationship with God by turning what once was a hot, burning spiritual fire into a cold, lukewarm pile of ashes. Look what God says he'll do with that in Revelation 2:4. This is Jesus talking to the church in the end times, the church of Laodicea. And he says to the church, "Nevertheless, I have this against you, that you've left your first love." The whole point of this message, if you leave it, you'll lose it. You've left your first love. Remember, therefore, here we go, from where you have fallen. In other words, don't forget how to go back to where you were. Remember where you were when you fell. Go back, that's where I'll be. Remember where you were when you walked away from me. Come back there, and I'll be there waiting for you. Nevertheless, I have this against you, that you left your first love. Therefore, remember therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do, here we go, the first works. Now here's what they lose. Or else, here's the punishment. Here's what they lose. They leave it. They lose it. If you leave it, here's what they lose. Or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. God says, if you leave me as your first love, I will remove your lampstand from its place. In other words, when God removes our lampstand, you know what he's removing? He's removing the light and the fire from our lives. The light is the witness of Jesus, the light of Christ that shines through us, that leads others to him. And the fire is our spiritual passion for God. When we leave, we lose. When we leave our first love for God, we lose our witness and our passion. And when the spiritual light goes out in a Christian, this is another thing that you can see. When you get farther away from God and that hole, that light, your heart's filled with light, and that light gets dimmer and dimmer and dimmer. When Christians are trying to operate their Christian life, when their light is so dim, they begin fumbling around in the darkness of the world. They trip over things that they never used to trip over before. They used to walk through and sail through life and dodge this and move that like Samson did in power and confidence. But without the light of God in their life, they're tripping and falling and over the littlest things, things that they never even thought about before. And their spiritual walk is reduced to a blind man's crawl, fumbling in the dark. You can't last long spiritually when your life is in that condition. But again, this isn't a gloom and doom, because we can get it all back. We can get it all back if we're willing to go back to what we left behind. We can get back what we lost. We can get our light back. We can get our fire back. We can get our joy back. The King will give everything back with value outed. Once again, the light will come on. And God's illumination, you know what that is? What God's illumination is? So many times somebody says, I feel God's calling me. What's he calling you to do? I don't know. And I always say, go home and pray about it. And they'll call me, well, I think it's to preach. What you think? Or you'll know. Well, you got to tell me, what's my calling? I don't know what your calling is, but I'm praying for you, because when the light comes on, you're going to know it. And it'll be all you think about from the time you get up till the time you go to bed. The light of God in our heart is God's illumination on our life that shows us in our heart and our mind. It lights us up so much that we know that we know that we know that this is our calling. I can't tell you why God's calling me to quit my job, but I know that he is. Well, what's he calling you to do? I don't know. But I've never been more excited about taking up my cross and following him wherever it is he leads me. That's God's illumination on our life. We can get that back. If you felt called to something at one time and you've left that and you've lost that, Go back to what you left behind. Pick it up. God's right there waiting with the same mantle. He'll reilluminate your heart and bring you into the purpose that He has created for your life. Amen? Luke 15 tells how the prodigal son left the father's house. Remember, if you leave, you lose. He lost his security. He lost a home. He lost a loving father and family. And the funny thing is, the prodigal son didn't even realize. He didn't think he'd lost anything. The moment he left, he had no regrets. I want it. Let's go. And I've shared many times that in that culture, in that time, taking your inheritance early and leaving is, we think of that with American thoughts, and it's not what we're thinking. Because back then, the youngest son didn't have the right to do that. It was the elder son who was in succession. A younger son coming and asking for his portion early was the same thing as saying, I'm gonna divorce you. I'm going to divorce myself from this family. And in that culture, if a child did that, a younger child did that, that family could never speak his name out loud. That person was dead. And if they came to the door begging, you couldn't even recognize him as family. They were cast out of the bloodline, out of the family. You were shunned forever. That was the magnitude of what this young boy did. But when he left, the father gave him what he wanted. When you leave, you lose. And he's strutting down to the big city, spending it on wine, women, and song. That's what the Bible says. He went out and partied his money away. And the Bible says it was when a famine came into the land. You see how this is starting to connect with our first story about the woman? Yes. A famine came into the land. Yes. And this boy began to realize the magnitude of if you leave, you lose. Because he was in the pig pen when the Bible said he came to himself. When he left, he didn't think he'd lose anything. That's the same lie that Satan's been telling Christians since Eve. And we're still falling for it. The reason Satan doesn't pitch up his game a little bit and come up with some new material is because he don't have to. We keep tripping in the same holes over and over and over again. Why should he have to do anything else? We keep falling. This is the same. The prodigal son fell into the same hole that Eve fell into. And there's believers today that are falling into the exact same hole. There's people that get out in the world like the prodigal son. They leave the father in the father's house, and they get out in the world. They leave their families in a lot of cases. They divorce their families. They get out there. They're partying. They're having affairs. They're doing all this stuff, and they think life is great. But I guarantee you that that will be short-lived, because a famine is about ready to come into their land, a spiritual famine that they're going to feel. And it's going to put them in the pig pen. And hopefully, while they're there, like the prodigal son, they will come to themselves. The Bible says that he came to himself. He woke up. That's what coming to yourself means. He woke up and he says, I had everything at my father's house. But just like the woman in the first story, he knew that he didn't have the right to go to his father and ask for anything back. So he said, I'm not even getting, that's unmitigated gall to ask for my position back, because I know I'll never get it. So I'm going to go to the father and I'm going to ask him if he'll hire me as a slave in his house. Because like the lady in our first text, he knew that he didn't have the right to get anything back. In the first story, it was the king was the only one that had the right to restore to the woman. In the story of the prodigal son, it's the father. Only the father had the right, the power, to restore that son back. And the Bible says while the young man was still afar off, the father saw him. And he ran to him. threw his arms around him, put a ring on his finger, he kissed him, put a ring on his finger, robe on his back, brought him back into the family. You see how that looks like a marriage? The prodigal son was away. The father embraces him, kisses him, puts a robe on his back and a ring on his finger. It's God's covenant. It's saying, I'm going to restoring you back in with value added, because now I'm going to throw you a party like none of my kids have ever had. The father welcomed him in and gave him a party. So he got back everything that he'd walked away from with value added, because that's how our God works. Amen. That's what the Father does to us. He's waiting to say, come on in, take it back. I'm right here where you left me. Come and get it. So I've talked about things that America has gotten stolen from them by the enemy, and what we as individual believers, and as I close and we stand, we're going to keep going with the live stream for a minute, but as we stand together, there's some things that the church has allowed Satan to steal from us. There's things that the church has left and lost. I believe that the church has left and lost the miracles, signs, and wonders. Yes. We've lost the baptism in the Holy Spirit. The majority of the church has lost these things, and the reason is because we've left the passion of our first love.
That's right, amen.
We no longer have an expectation for a powerful move of God in our life or in our services. And before we'll ever have them in a church service, in any church anywhere, it has to start in the lives of us as individuals. When we have a personal revival, then the church is going to get into revival. The church has left honest praise and pure heart worship because we've left it out of our daily lives. There's a lot of people that only praise and worship on Sunday mornings. It's the only time you ever see them singing praises to God and worshiping God. This needs to be part of our daily life. Because if we lose it in our daily life, we're not going to have it here, because the signs have shown themselves. The church... worship is something you come into the house of God, come into the Father's house to give. You give praise to God. But now the enemy has come into the camp and stolen that biblical principle, and they've reversed it. They say, come into the house and get. Come into the church. So we've traded man to God worship for man to man entertainment. Instead of coming in and giving praise, we come in to get something. So the church has lost separation from sin because we left true discipleship. We've left our first love because we've chosen as a church worldwide, we've chosen to stop teaching the true message in Acts chapter 2. The Holy Spirit has become the lemon next to the pie. Sidebar issue. The Holy Spirit of God is our power source.
Yes.
We have to have an expectation of the move of God in our own personal lives. We have to go back to preaching in churches about the power of the Holy Spirit, the power in pleading the blood, the power in the precious blood of the Lamb. We've got to go back to talking about it, because we need to take it back, starting with you and me in our individual lives, and that'll carry over into this church. We need to take it back. In the name of Jesus, we need to take back everything that we've walked away from, and God will give it all back with value added. I know that the Holy Spirit of God is waiting patiently to move in a mighty way. But He cannot move in a church until He first moves in the hearts of the people that go to that church. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. I hope the Holy Spirit spoke deeply into your heart through today's message. You know, we have this incredible opportunity at this point in time. We've got this technology at our fingertips that the disciples and the apostles could only dream of. So if the message spoke to you today, then forward that message, share it with a friend or a family member, because chances are they could use it too. That's the beauty. If you don't think there's anything that you could do for the Lord, if you don't feel you have a talent for any sort of ministry, there's two things you could do. You can always be a prayer warrior, and you can share the gospel of Jesus Christ simply by forwarding these messages to a friend or a family member. If you'd like to help support Servant's Heart Worship Center, we would truly appreciate it, and we want you to know that we will always be good stewards with everything that God supplies this church. Your tithes are for your local church, so don't tithe to this church unless you're a part of this church family. But if you'd like to make an offering, a donation, I guarantee you it's going to go to a good cause to help support this ministry and to further the gospel of Jesus Christ throughout the nation and the other parts of the world. So if you'd like to donate, just click the donate button or go to our website at servantsheartworshipcenter.com and follow the instructions from there. Thank you, and God bless you.